call. So I couldn't make it. Beverly wouldn't drive by herself. So.
Okay.
We want this parish to suffer.
Hi. Oh, don't get up.
Good morning, Beverly.
Good morning, Beverly.
I'm used to getting up.
Thank you. Oh, down a little bit. Thank you so much, Vaughn. Good morning, and welcome to Church of Our Saviour. A very special welcome if you are new or visiting with us this morning, whether you're here with us in the sanctuary, whether you're joining us via the live stream. Vaughn, can you get me down just a little bit on mic one? Thank you so much, good sir. As we always say here at the Church of Our Savior, we are better because you choose to spend time among us, particularly on this weekend of wonderful events. Last night in the sanctuary was filled with amazing women leaders speaking about ministry. And this evening we'll be celebrating our Lunar New Year celebration. We have a wonderful guest with us, the Right Reverend Catherine Jeffers Shorey, who when she was presiding bishop was the most reverend, of course. She's here with us all weekend, but I invite you to center yourself. Children, as they always are welcome to go out for Children's Church. They will return for Holy Eucharist. They're always, always welcome to stay with their parents. But I invite us all to take a moment to center ourselves. One announcement I wanted to make was the first hymn is hymn 129. It is incorrect in your bulletin, so when you stand in a few moments, turn to 129 in the blue hymnal in front of you. But I invite us all to take a moment to center ourselves and to be aware of God's presence at this time and in this place.
Blessed be the one holy and living God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who pours out your Spirit upon your sons and daughters, grant that we, following the example of your servant Florence Lee Timoy, chosen priest in your church, may with faithfulness, patience, and tenacity proclaim your holy gospel to all the nations. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting.
Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the churches in Galatia. Before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith could be revealed. Therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you, as you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. The word of the Lord.
Are you? Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet, if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken, and so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Good morning. And Gung Hai Phat Choi. The beginning of the Lunar New Year is this weekend. I am grateful for your bishop's invitation and your rector's invitation to be here. And I look forward to more of the celebration of this weekend. As I sat down several days ago to pen this sermon, Seattle's classical music station was playing a traditional piece courtesy of the Hong Kong Philharmonic. It's called Mo Li Hua, or Jasmine Flower. It's a graceful and haunting and pure and gentle piece. And I think it's an image of Saint Timoy. She was the first woman ordained priest in the Anglican Communion. She was born to a Christian family. Her father trained as a physician and later became headmaster of a school for poor children. He had three wives.
The first one died. The second one was the official wife. And the third was a concubine and Timoy's mother. Timoy means much beloved daughter. In spite of it, her brothers got first crack at higher education. Timoy had to wait until the household could cope without her labor. But when she was 21, the family was able to send her for higher education. Timoy took Florence as her baptismal name, following Florence Nightingale's example of selfless love. And it is very much true of Timoy. We heard an image of her story in today's first reading. St. Paul challenges his community to recognize that in Christ, we're no longer children who are unable to make hard decisions. In the body of Christ, we're meant to recognize that the love of God within us is already being and becoming our companion and guide. As full members of the body of Christ, we're meant to listen to the Spirit rather than blindly obeying the most forceful person nearby or the traditional culture's decision maker. We're meant to make decisions faithfully. Timoy's life was filled with courageous decisions in an era of cultural transition and much war. At 27, she completed her higher education with marks so high that the Hong Kong press lauded her accomplishment. Her rector encouraged her to go to theological college, and she would have been the second Chinese woman to do so. But instead, she went to teach in her father's school. She lasted 9 months. And then she went to Union Theological School in Canton. Her idol ended in 1937 as Japan marched into China and carpet bombed major cities. She and her fellow students became first aid workers, succoring the wounded and the dying, and then as a refugee herself, made her way to Hong Kong. The Bishop of Hong Kong, Ronald Hall, sent her to All Saints Kowloon as a leg worker to care for refugees. In 1940, he reassigned her to Macau, which the Japanese did not enter. She made a surreptitious return to Hong Kong and was ordained deaconess on the 22nd of May in 1941. At Christmas that year, Hong Kong fell to Japan. And Deaconess Timoy learned that her father was sick and penniless. She borrowed $10 from the British consul in Macau, dressed up as an old woman, smuggled herself back into Hong Kong, and brought out both her father and Bishop Mok Shao Tsang of Canton, who authorized her to celebrate Eucharist for that congregation in Macau as a deaconess. Deaconess Lee scavenged food for that community, ministered to the dead and dying, and buried many, many people. The local girls' school let her eat with the students, and 70 children from that school asked to be baptized. Hundreds more were baptized during the war. Bishop Hall heard about many accounts of Timoy's ministry, and he recognized that her ministry was priestly. He wrote to the Archbishop of Canterbury and telling him that he was planning to ordain her. Archbishop Temple responded, "I am not an advocate of the ordination of women." Hall's answer, "Prejudice shouldn't keep the faithful from the sacraments." And Bishop Hall asked to meet with her. It meant a dangerous journey over 140 miles of Japanese-held territory. She walked, bicycled, took a boat, rode in a sedan chair, with help from many Christian families, some of whom sent bodyguards. Bishop Hall and Timoy met in Xinjiang for 3 days, examining her. When he was satisfied, they went to a church 30 miles away in Shaoqing, where Hall ordained her amidst an ecumenical congregation. In a small, out-of-the-way place, a new reality was born. A woman bringing love and offering saving grace to all sorts and conditions of humanity. Days later, the city was bombed and the church damaged. And like the Magi, the two clergy went home, each by a different way. By the time Mother Timoy returned to Macau, the war was ending. Bishop Hall's secretary asked her to come to Hong Kong. He asked if she knew that she was the first lady priest. No, she answered. The Lambeth Boys Club was in revolt, and the bishop's secretary told her that they simply wouldn't have it, and that, I quote, "If you carry on as a priest, he, Bishop Hall, will have to leave his work in Hong Kong." She was terribly upset and wrote to Hall, "I would like to keep quiet to help the church. You are an important man. I am a mere worm, a tiny little worm." Now, isn't it a worm's vocation to poke holes in supposedly solid ground and undermine barriers? In 1946, Bishop Hall asked her to resign from priestly ministry with plans to wait for the debate at the next Lambeth Conference. When they did, the 349 bishops advised, quote, that the ordination of Florence Lee Timoy would be against the tradition and order of the Anglican Communion, and they dismissed the need for further examination of ordaining women. And furthermore, at the same conference, they, quote, affirmed that discrimination between men on the grounds of race alone is inconsistent with the principles of Christ's religion. The church has not always been known for consistency. 2 Lambeth conferences and 20 years later, the bishops encouraged the ordination of women deacons and stopped calling them deaconesses. At the following Lambeth Conference in 1978, the bishops recognized the autonomy of each of its member churches and the legal right of each church to make its own decision about women priests. There are still 3 provinces in the Anglican Communion that do not ordain women at all: Melanesia, Papua New Guinea, and Southeast Asia. And more than half the provinces have not yet ordained any women bishops. About a fourth of the communion doesn't yet permit women bishops. In 1946, in the middle of this conflict, Bishop Hall sent Timoy to Hopo, very near Vietnam. She was to call people together and teach at 2 different schools. Within 2 years, she wrote him, "The church was moving again, and most of the 10,000 people in the town knew me." After the war, Bishop Hall sent her and 7 other clergy to the United States for renewal and recreation, with orders that she not disclose her priesthood. She was housed in convents where she wouldn't be recognized. 6 months later, they returned to their posts in China, where society was already beginning to be dismantled and reformed. Bishop Hall reauthorized her to serve as priest in Hopo, the last place to be liberated. In early 1951, the communists took over the church compound and moved her in with other pastors. An indigenous and anti-colonial way of being church began to emerge in China, It's called the three-self movement: self-support, self-government, and self-propagation. Mother Timoy embraced and taught this theology at her theological school. The three-self movement was a forerunner and a significant influence on what was happening and emerging here in the United States in the 50s and 60s, then mostly called total ministry. The whole Anglican Communion, however, is still wrestling with what we call ministry of all the baptized, lay people, deacons, priests, and bishops. Timoy functioned as a priest until Christmas of 1957, when the Great Leap Forward set clergy and intellectuals to menial work. Her worm ministry continued as captain of the chickens and rabbits. She was humiliated, robbed, nearly starved, and made to wear a sign that read, "Backward priest opposed to the revolution." Eventually, the Cultural Revolution fizzled, and in 1979, churches were permitted to reopen. 2 years later, she immigrated to Toronto. The ordination of women and all sorts and conditions of humanity and the honoring of local culture are essential to the fullness of God's creation. Each and every human being and creature is honored and valued in God's good creation, including the creative work of worms. Timoy called her vocation making friends for Jesus. Another way of seeing Simon Peter's great catch of fish. We're all charged to go fishing, to invite worms who poke holes that bring life to dead terrain. Don't just invite them. Celebrate and make friends with those who work and open the soil, who honor God's good and varied creation, and who make friends for Jesus. Give thanks for Mother Lee Timoy.
We pray in the name of Christ, the Prince of Peace. We give thanks for Florence Lee Timoy, for her calling to be a priest in your church, to witness your love and faithfulness, and to be the hands and heart of Christ for those among whom she lived and worked. We give you thanks, O Lord. We give thanks for Bishop Muck, for recognizing Timoy's calling and licensing her, and for Bishop Hall for ordaining her as a priest. Thank you for their courage and their prophetic actions.
We give you thanks,
Lord. We give thanks for the women who have persevered in following your calling in their lives, for overcoming the obstacles of prejudice, self-doubt, and lack of resources, keeping hope and faith alive that you were with them and in their hearts' desires. give thanks for the priestly ministry of women in the Anglican Communion, that through their lives and ministries we have gained a fuller understanding of who we are as beloved children of God and fellow heirs with Christ. We give thanks that for 35 years the Episcopal Church has been able to consecrate women as bishops, to share in the oversight of your priests and people, helping the world to see the mutuality that women and men have in Christ.
We give you thanks, Lord.
For all those who were denied their calling, for those who died before the church accepted women as priests and bishops, for those who are still prevented from following their calling,
Lord, have mercy.
We entrust the future to you and ask that we and the whole church would repent of our blindness and sin, so that all who claim the name of Christ may more closely walk the way of truth, love, and peace.
May heaven come and your will be done. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, by your Holy Spirit, you have made us one with your saints in heaven and on earth. Grant that in our earthly pilgrimage we may always be supported by this fellowship of love and prayer, and know ourselves to be surrounded by their witness to your power and mercy. We ask this for the sake of Jesus Christ, in whom all our intercessions are acceptable through the Spirit, and who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Let us proclaim our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge the baptism of the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Good morning. And again, welcome to Church of Our Saviour. A very special welcome if you're new or visiting with us this morning. As we always say here at the Church of Our Saviour, we are better because you choose to spend time among us. So thank you so much for joining us this morning. A very special welcome to Bishop Catherine. It's been so wonderful to hear your wisdom and to be a part of your ministry. Thank you so much for being with us. There's also a few other guests. One in particular I want to, the Reverend Mary Tariri is in the back. She's a rock star in the diocese and spoke so well last night. There's also, just in front of Mary is, many of you may remember Julie Kelly, who used to work with us back in the day. So thank you for joining us, Julie, and welcome back home to Church of Our Saviour. I do invite you to look at your messenger in your bulletin announcements held therein. I'll highlight just a few. After a busy weekend, we have a very busy week here at Church of Our Saviour. Lent is coming. As I always say, Lent for me is a get-to, not a have-to. It's an opportunity to get closer to God and with one another. And so, but I do invite you to join us on Tuesday night for Shrove Tuesday at 6 p.m. Many of you may know at Church of Our Saviour, we have a wonderful, Hannah's in the back of raising her hands up. We have a wonderful tradition at Church of Our Saviour. In addition to eating pancakes, which will be actually cooked by Vito, who often sits right here, his family runs Eastside Italian Deli, so it'll be very good pancakes. He'll be cooking the pancakes. But in addition to that, many of you may know that we have a tradition of having a talent show at Shrove Tuesday. I always think of Basil Johnson, who died this past year, who would always end Shrove Tuesday with a wonderful poem and a joke. And so I know I'll be thinking about Basil this year on Shrove Tuesday, and then I invite you to begin Lent in prayer. We'll have three services. At 7 a.m. will be a spoken Ash Wednesday service led by Jonathan Burke. At 12 noon here in the historic sanctuary, we'll have a Holy Eucharist with imposition of ashes, and then at 7:30 p.m. we'll have our choir and music lead us through an Ash Wednesday service and Holy Eucharist. So I do invite you to begin Lent in prayer, and then you'll see there are several opportunities for practices for you to take on during this Lent, including I'll be teaching the adult forums during Lent. I'll be doing an Episcopal 101 class. So whether you grew up Episcopalian or whether you're new to the church, it's a wonderful opportunity to get a survey course, if you will, about the Episcopal Church. In addition to that, the Reverend Marilyn Obernick will be teaching a class on Barbara Brown Taylor's book, An Altar in the World, at 5:30 p.m. on Sunday evenings. I'll also be hosting a dinner, like a simple soup dinner, on Sunday evenings, and so I do invite you to come for that experience. In addition to that, Julie will be doing her prayer group, as she always does. So wonderful. What's that? So if you want more, Julie is still looking for more people to take on individuals to pray for this coming Lent, and so it's not too late to join that experience. Hannah Riley will be leading a special Spark class for our children, and opposite that, Tim Hartley will be leading a parenting support group, if you will. I know I need that as a parent. And so I do invite you to join us this Lent in any way, shape, and form that makes sense for you. In addition to that, this coming Thursday is a Sages at noon, thanks to the great leadership of Bev. And so I do invite you to join us for Sages this coming week. I think I got all the announcements. I think I got them. And I also invite you to come back at 4 p.m. As we celebrate the Lunar New Year celebration. There'll be no less than four choirs with us and people from across the diocese as we celebrate Lunar New Year. And as the bishop said so well, the ordination of Florence Lee tomorrow. I also thank the many, many lay leaders who have enabled this wonderful weekend of celebration of many different varieties. This wonderful lion hung in the sanctuary was done by Vic May, who was here till about 3 a.m. on Saturday morning with Hannah doing all this work. And so I cannot begin to thank all of the individuals who have spent time, energy, and love as we celebrate amazing things. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries last week or this coming week? Nancy, fabulous. Oh, birthday, I'm assuming, both of you?
Yes.
94. 94 years young. 94 and 36. Okay. Okay. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Abundant and loving God, we thank you for these wonderful servants, witnesses to your grace and love in their families and in this church community. We ask you to bless them on the anniversary of their birth. Bless their bodies, bless their relationships, and bless them as they continue to discover who you call them to be. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday. Thank you. I also want to make sure we thank Mary Kingman, who's sitting over here, who, with Anne Seitz, made all these beautiful vestments for our altar as well as for our clergy. That's such amazing. Thank you, Mary. I invite all of you to receive communion with us this morning. One way we witness in our ministries, whether we are bishops or priests or deacons or especially laity, is by coming back to the altar each week, reaching out our hands and receiving the body and blood of Jesus Christ. If you would like the sacrament of baptism for you or a loved one, please come talk to us. We would love to celebrate your baptism. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
God of Sarah, Hagar, and Deborah, at Christmas you gave us your presence. At Easter you dismantled sin and death. And at Pentecost you empowered us to bear your image and spread your grace. God of Chloe, Phoebe, and Priscilla, in mission you equip us to go to the four corners of the earth and rediscover what your Spirit is doing and meet you in the face of the stranger. God of Euodia, Syntyche, and Apphia, in ministry you share with us the abundance of your love in sacrament and story, in prayer and teaching, in reconciliation and bringing your world home to you. And so we gladly thank you with saints and angels and archangels and all the company of heaven singing the hymn of your unending praise. God of Ruth, Naomi, and Esther, in Jesus, you show us the extent of mission and the cost of ministry. Send your Holy Spirit that your people may be filled with love, joy, and peace, and that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again he gave thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. God of Junia, Tryphena, and Tryphosa, as you take bread and wine and make them the bearers of your Son's risen life, take our flesh and blood and make them the channels of your peace. Bless the ministry of women throughout the Anglican Communion and beyond. Transform your church that it may resemble the generosity, joy, and abundance of your Trinity. God of Julia, Persis, and Claudia, raise up those whose gifts have been suppressed, neglected, ignored, or rejected. Renew your people through humble service and prophetic witness, that your name may be known in the face of injustice, poverty, and tyranny. God of Mary, Mary Magdalene, and Elizabeth, show your glory through agents of healing and learning, and shower your people with your love.
until the day comes when every eye beholds you, full of grace and truth, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
we break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We are many, we are one body,
because we all share in the one bread.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you gather us to be your holy people, the body of Christ in the world. Increase in us the virtues of patience and devotion, that like Li Timoy, we may live always in your radiance. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
The blessing of the God of Abraham and Sarah, and of Jesus born of our sister Mary, and of the Holy Spirit who broods over creation as a mother over her children, be with you this day and forevermore.
Amen. Amen.
Go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.